What's up guys, how do you do? Welcome to today's edition of Programming Wizards TV. In this class, we're going to see, we'll continue with the reactive programming series, and we're going to discuss the concept of push versus pull in reactive programming. So this is what we're going to see right here. So first, of course, reactive programming with RxJava. RxJava is actually the library that we're using, okay? So push versus pull, this is what we're talking about. So first of all, what is RxJava? Well, RxJava is a popular implementation of the reactive extensions for Java. So it's actually influenced by functional programming. Now, if we talk about reactive extensions, this is actually a set of extensions or a set of libraries for different languages that are free and open source that normally we can use to implement reactive programming in various languages. As you know, languages like Java, C Sharp, Python, these languages are object oriented, okay? And normally reactive programming is normally implemented in functional programming languages. So reactive extensions therefore is a library that adds these particular functional features to these languages to allow us build Rx or reactive applications. So not only do we have the RxJava, but for example, we also have a reactive extension for .NET. We have the RxJS that you can also use for JavaScript. We have for Python, they're actually different implementations. So the one we're working with particularly today is RxJava, which is the implementation for Java. So we can use, of course, RxJava for both general Java development as well as Android development. And in fact, we'll see Rx Android in a separate tutorial. So RxJava basically allows us to compose synchronous and event-based programs. So we compose these programs with functions and not objects. So normally with object-oriented programming, you are used to working with objects. Now, object-oriented programming, the focus is normally objects. And as you know, as you may already know, objects normally do have state. Okay, for example, you create your objects, and these objects, they are going to be maintaining a state, okay, a global state. So as your application changes, basically, as users work with your application, what is happening is that the state of the application or its data is actually changing. So this actually has side effects. And of course, React with RxJava with functional programming, as opposed to having our application being object-oriented, we have it being function oriented. So functions are actually much simpler in that functions are normally stateless, okay? So the functions, we model them after just the mathematical functions that you know. So these functions, are the way they work is very simple. They take input, they work on the input, and then they submit the result. There's nothing like the state. So this therefore allows us, of course, to think in terms of streams with RxJava, as opposed to in terms of objects. So there's something that we call an observable, a type that we call an observable, and this is basically a type that represents a stream of data or events. So every time you hear us talking about an observable, think of it as a stream of data, okay, or a stream of events. So it is this observable and the observer pattern which is actually at the core of the RxJava and reactive programming in general. So reactive programming and RxJava do involve what we call data pushing. So both observer types and the observables, remember, observable we've said is represents the stream of data. Now the observer on the other hand represents the subscriber to that particular stream. So you have the stream of data, however there's of course some parties that are interested in that stream of data, that they want to process that particular data. So those parties, those are what we call subscribers, and they are what we call, in this case, what we represent using the observer type. So both these observers as well as the observables, okay, that is both the stream of data and the subscribers, both of them do support these events, or they support events or data being pushed at them. And in fact, in majority of cases, this normally happens asynchronously, okay? So however, they also support what we call, they also support async pull, And async pool is basically an asynchronous way of delivering feedbacks. Now, we've said they involve, of course, pushing data being pushed at them, and they also involve a pool, okay, or a sync pool, whereby it's just a way of delivering feedback. So you push data, but also the feedbacks can also be delivered via the async pool. So for us to receive these particular feedbacks via the async pool, now the async pool is also known as the reactive pool, the observer as well as the observables. That is, remember, the observables, the stream of data, or the observer is the subscriber. Both of these have to pair up, okay? And when they pair up, we call this a subscription. So the observer, therefore, as we said, represents the stream of data. Now, the observer is actually what subscribes to our observable. So the observer subscribes to observable, and this is what we call the subscription. So let's look at the observable interface signature so as to see, have a brief idea of how it works. So it's an interface observable. As you can see, it's generic, so receiving type T right here. Now we have the subscription, and then we have the subscribe. The subscribe, as you can see, returns as a subscription. It subscribes, then returns a subscription. And what are we subscribing? Well, we're subscribing an observer. So observers, we receive it as a parameter and subscribe it to this observable and return a subscription. So let's also look, that's an observable, and here also we have the observer, which, remember, is the subscriber. So this is also an interface, a generic interface of type T. Now this observer normally has a set some events, three events right here. First, we're going to talk about them in a short while. You can see we have the on next. Okay, now on next is receiving a type T. Then we have the on error, it's receiving a throwable. Then we have the on completed, which is not receiving anything. So the point to remember is that the observer subscribes to the observable. Okay, so after the observer has subscribed to our observable, then there are three events that can be pushed to the observer. Okay, so these events right here are the ones that we've listed right here. First, we have the data can be pushed to the observer via the on next. So on next is a function right here, as you can see, that through which we push data. As you can see, we pass in the type of data. We push the data to the observer or to the subscriber via the on next method. So this on next can be invoked once or multiple times. In fact, it can even be invoked infinitely. Then there's also the errors right here. So errors can also be pushed to our subscriber or to our observer, and we use the on error function. So this on error function, this is what we call a terminal event. Okay, so this on next, on error, and on completed, these are events, and this on error is actually a terminal event in that it gets called only once, and either it or the on completed, okay, which basically represents the completion event, will get called. Okay, they get called once, and just one of them can be called. You cannot have both on error and on completed being called at the same time. So that is it. Those are the three events that are supported by our observer. So that's it, guys. I've explained to you guys the concept of push versus pull right here in reactive programming. So we've also seen the observer, which is the subscriber, and the observable, which is the stream of data that is being subscribed to. So yeah, we'll continue doing more, building more, building our knowledge of reactive programming. So you don't want to miss them out. So to stay tuned, go ahead, subscribe to our channel, Programming Users TV, and like the video. We'll post this tutorial on our website, camposha.info. At this, take care. I'll catch you in the next class.